Welcome to the sideboard at the Dallas Legacy Open. I'm here with Justin McGuire.
How's it going?
Justin's off to a fine start in the Legacy Open, playing a deck that's a little bit of cake and eat it too, I would describe it. You've got a lot of cake.
I love the value, so.
Cascade's been catching on in Legacy, I think it's safe to say. Shardless Bug that Jerry started developing, the Jund deck that did very well at Grand Prix Denver. This deck combines some elements of both. You've got Shardless Agent, complemented by Bloodbraid Elf, to go with the most of the standard blue stuff. But you've also added in a lot of cards that come from other decks, like Noble Heart for acceleration, Stoneforge Mystic for an actual equipment package. You have the Lightning Bolt aspect. Where'd you start? What deck did you have first, I guess, is
so,
the best question.
I started with Rug first. I saw people were talking about it a little bit. I saw Bloodbraid Elf finally saw some play in the Grand Prix, as you saw. And then I love Rug. I've played in all formats and everything, so I started there. And I started with 4 Bloodbraid, 4 Shardless Agent, 4 Jace. And I found too many 4 drops.
Sure.
But, as I found, Cascading, awesome. Best thing ever. But I was lacking in targets. Also, I was jealous of Deathrite Shaman. All these Jund decks, all these black-based decks, they all had their own accelerator. So I wanted to go with black, except all the black spells you want turn one. And so as a fourth color, that's not very good.
Sure.
So I decided to start looking elsewhere. I looked at accelerators. I'm like, birds. Obviously, the Bloodbraid into birds thing has been discussed forever. So I went with Noble. And Noble basically made a white splash free. So I wanted a better 2-drop because my Cascades, as I said, hitting Visions is awesome. Hitting Goyf can be okay, but there was no like immediate impact.
Yeah.
So I went with Stoneforge. I played at an 8-man at like my local game store a long time ago and saw some guy playing some crazy 4-color thing, and I'm like, that's awesome, but it's missing something. So as we were discussing this, it was like 2 a.m., we were discussing it, and my breakthrough was, let's add Storm.
Okay, so you're maximizing Cascade throughout the deck. Obviously, that's like the general goal, Hand Disruption being not so great. You've got a lot of card advantage in this deck.
Yes.
Between the Mystics, the Visions, which are huge against any control deck. I mean, it feels like you've got to be liking your matchup against decks like Bug, right?
Anything fair, I wanted to be more fair. I wanted to have the fairest deck in the room. If I got paired against someone who wasn't trying to kill me on turn 3, I wanted to, by turn 4, have seen like 8 more cards than them.
Sure.
So.
It seems like definitely an ideal thing. You've also got Sylvan Library and Sensei's Divining Top cards that are long known to just work in those grindy games especially well.
Well, with Cascade, being able to manipulate the top of your library is
even
very
better.
Key.
Yeah.
So. It helps you set up that dream, the Bloodbraid into the Shardless Agent, into Visions, and just watch your opponent kind of slump in their chair.
Have you Yahtzeed anyone in the tournament?
Yes, I did. Actually, round 1, I cast a turn 3 Bloodbraid off of Noble, and hit Shardless into Visions, and it was awesome.
I imagine the opponent did not agree.
He wasn't too happy. He was playing John.
One of the more interesting things about your deck, which I actually saw as I was wandering the rows, was you have a sideboard that kind of offers some transformational capacity.
Yes.
You've got 3 counterbalances and 2 more Sensei's Divining Tops to go with the one you've already got made.
Mm-hmm.
Where are we bringing in the counterbalance top engine, and where did that come from?
The counterbalance top engine, it's there for all the decks, like I said, the ones trying to kill you on turns 2, on turns 3. Basically, going after the main deck, I knew there was... I'm playing Cascade, so there's no way to play like Spell Pierce, Spell Snare, like any of those cheap instant speed disruption. So I knew that my answers had to be permanent based. And I already kind of wanted a top to control the top of my library, so I went with Counterbalance. It's the best at what it does, that once you get it going, it's just they can't play.
Sure, a proactive sideboard strategy with Cascade is way better than a reactive one. I think over the years that's been proven quite well. Along the same note, you have Rest in Peace, which is an excellent card to cascade into when it's good.
Yeah.
Obviously, Shardless Agent being able to just shut down a dredge deck at random, pretty strong.
Actually, the Rest in Peace has been there for a lot more matchups than you would think. I actually bring them in against Bug and against Jund.
Sure.
Against both of those decks, Deathrite Shaman and Tarmogoyf are so key to killing you that if you're able to turn those offline, half their deck doesn't work the way it's supposed to.
Oh, so you just switch your Tarmogoyfs out for the Rest in Pieces, basically?
Against Jund, normally I'll take out the Goyfs and, like, Forces.
Sure.
And I'll bring in, like... That's why there's a Bloodbraid and 2 clicks in there. They actually give me more threats while providing the advantage. Getting even more fair, basically. Against decks trying to grind you out, Bloodbraid is just... it's the best at what it does.
Okay. I like the Vanilla Eclipse, one of my personal favorite cards. And the fourth Bloodbraid makes total sense when you frame it that way. You've definitely, you're shaping the deck to just be a different, slightly different deck, I should say, in each matchup, which is strong sideboarding. I imagine the Mindbreak Trap and the Pyroblast just wound up being sort of hedge bets for some plans. We've got one extra card to take out, a little something to bring in.
They were, a lot of times you'll find yourself taking out six cards and only needing five. And so they're just the cards that are in there for like, okay, well, this is good in addition to what I already have. And so Pyroblast, it's one of the best cards in Legacy just because all the other best cards are blue.
Sure.
And then Mindbreak Trap is, once again, I don't want to die on turn two.
Mindbreak Trap is also a nice counterspell in that it obviously dodges your Cascade effects, but can also be played very cheap early on against the deck shape. I like the Mindbreak Traps, and I like the deck. It definitely looks very cool. What are the matchups you're hoping to avoid in the room? Obviously, you said like unfair decks. Do any of them like leap out as particularly bad for you?
The two that are the most concerning are Show and Tell and Reanimator.
Okay.
Show and Tell, I basically have no outs to resolve Show and Tell, and Reanimator can obviously just do its thing and put Grizzlebrand or Iona into play too quickly for me to handle. At least against them, Counterbalance Top is a hedge because all their reanimation effects are 1 and 2.
Sure.
Show and Tell costs 3. I have 4 3 drops in the main deck. So Show and Tell is the one that I really want to avoid.
Show and Tell, okay, a tough matchup. The Vendilion Clicks, I imagine, pull a little bit of weight in that matchup, but you have to have them.
Yeah, there's only 2. So.
And they could always just have, you know, another thing in their hand.
Yeah.
Very dangerous.
Well, they also have as much disruption. Actually, they have more disruption than me.
Sure.
So that's the main thing.
All right, well, you've started off, I believe, your X1 in this event?
Yes, I'm X1.
All right, well, congratulations on that start, and good luck in the rest of the tournament.
All right, thank you.